The International Solar Energy Society, ISES, is a non-profit UN-accredited membership NGO. The ISES vision is to achieve 100% renewable energy for all, used efficiently and wisely. We represent a diverse membership of academics, researchers, energy practitioners, consultants, students, businesses, and advocates. ISES works together with like-minded organizations from countries around the world to advance the renewable energy transformation. By becoming a member of ISES, you are supporting the 100% renewable energy movement. The presentations and recording of this webinar will be available for 24 hours on our website. After that time, we will post them to the members area. If you are a member of the International Solar Energy Society, please log in and click on Members Area in the top level menu, and you will already see the library of our past webinars. If you are not a member, please visit our membership page, and I really do encourage you to have a look at our services and benefits for members and sign up. That's join.ises.org. You are welcome and encouraged to ask questions at any time throughout the webinar. To ask a question, select the questions pane on your screen and type in your question. Please specify who your question is directed to. Questions will be addressed after all the presentations in a moderated Q&A session. We would also like to encourage you to use the ISES discussion forum on LinkedIn to continue the Q&A and the discussion even after the webinar has ended. Through sponsorships, donations, and also the support of ISES members, we can continue hosting these free webinars. Today's webinar is sponsored by the International Energy Agency's Photovoltaic Power Systems Program, the IEA-PVPS. The IEA-PVPS has just recently published the 21st edition of the Trends in PV Applications Report 2016. The full report is available as a handout for you who have joined this webinar this morning, and is also available to download directly from the IEA-PVPS website. Today's webinar will browse through the main findings of the report. It will detail the state of the global PV market and its industry and the challenges ahead. The IEA Photovoltaic Power Systems Program, PVPS, is one of the collaborative R&D agreements, technology collaboration programs, established within the IEA, and since its establishment in 1993, the PVPS participants have been conducting a variety of joint projects in the application of photovoltaic conversion of solar energy into electricity. A special thank you to the IEA PVPS for sponsoring today's webinar. Let me briefly take you through our agenda. From Brussels this morning, we have our first speaker, Gaëtan Masson. Gaëtan is the IEA PVPS Task 1 Operating Agent and will begin with a presentation on PV market developments and drivers for growth. Our second speaker is joining us from Tokyo, Japan, so it's the evening there, Izumi Kaizuka from RTS Corporation. Izumi will speak about the state of the PV industry in her presentation. Our third and final speaker is joining us from Finland, Christian Breyer from Lappeenranta University of Technology, and he will explain to us PV in 100% RES scenarios. Let's begin the presentations now. Gaëtan, the screen is now yours. And please make sure to unmute your microphone.
So, thank you, Joanna. I would like first to welcome everyone here to this webinar, and we will try, the three of us, to browse the situation of the PV market, the PV industry, and the prospects for renewable energy development. I would like to thank ISES and my fellow co-presenters for the organization. Through some of the conclusions of a report that has been published 1 month ago by the IEA-PVPS, the Trends 2016 in Photovoltaic Applications. This is a report that is written now for more than 21 years, it's 21st edition, and from the first to the last one, things have changed dramatically in the PV sector, but the IEA-PVPS is still there, analyzing and researching what makes the evolution of the PV markets. Joanna, you've said a lot about the IEA-PVPS, so I will not spend too much time on that. Just would like to add, we have 30 members, 25 countries, the European Commission, and four main associations. South Africa just joined the program. And this program comprises basically almost all countries where PV is developing, either from a market point of view, from an industry point of view, or from a research point of view. It's managed by the International Energy Agency, and it allows us for, as I'm saying, more than 20 years to have an in-depth and independent look at the way how the PV market is developing. I would like just to start with this little picture, just to remind something. It's not only about oil, it's about everything that is submitted to the laws of economy. Prices are driven by demand and supply. This is the case for oil, this is the case for PV as well. And basically, if we are looking at something that many people have already seen, the incredible evolution of the PV market in the last 15 years, we can see that the 51 gigawatts that have been reached in 2015 are the consequence of an impressive development of PV in the last 15 years. And this development, as we will see, is going to continue. What is extremely interesting here is to see that this evolution is not continuous. The market evolved from one year to another, sometimes dramatically, sometimes it stopped and consolidated, as it was the case in 2012 and 2014. So it's a bumpy ride, I would say, but when we're looking at the perspective on 10 or 15 years, the evolution is quite impressive. We had at the end of 2015 more than 228 gigawatt of PV installations, and if we're looking at what's happening in 2016, we might reach, perhaps in the best case, close to 300 gigawatts at the end of this year. Now, we need to have a look at how the markets has developed in 2015. And the first market in 2015 was China, followed by Japan, followed by all European countries together, and followed by the USA. What is extremely interesting is that in 2016, we might have China, the USA, Japan, and Europe still in the top four of the four regions. So even if things are changing and the magnitude of PV installation is changing, we still have the same countries that are contributing a lot to the PV markets. If we are looking at the contribution of the first, the top five and the top 10 PV markets to the market in 2015, we can see that basically in the five last years, this hasn't changed much. And the conclusion can be extremely simple. It means that basically we always have one market which represents, I would say, between 25% and 30% of the global PV markets. Then we have the top five markets which represent in between 70% and close to 80%, and the top 10 markets which represents more than 90% or close to 90% of the markets. What does it mean? It means that the PV market is still concentrated, and even if it has increased significantly in the last 5 years, the shape of the market remains similar, with a few markets leading the development. Something else, when we're looking at the market, is how the market is segmented. And 15 years ago, the PV market was highly decentralized with, important share of off-grid applications. At that time, the PV market was extremely small, and the level of off-grid applications in developing countries were accounting for more than 15% of the markets. But something changed with the massive development of PV starting in, I would say, 2007-2008. It's the development of the centralized PV application, ground-mounted utility-scale applications. And the rapid decline in prices has been a tremendous driver for the development of centralized PV applications, to the extent that in 2015 this represented more than 60% of the markets, a share that has increased in absolute terms from 2011 to 2015. And this is what we can see when we are looking at the PV market globally. It's quite obvious that most announcements for PV development in emerging markets, and I'm not saying emerging countries, are coming from installation in the centralized segments. Utility scale applications are the ones that are developing very fast for the time being, which also means that everything that relates to decentralized PV is declining in terms of absolute value, in terms of relative value. Now, we could have a look at what it means in terms of relative value. And here it's quite interesting as well, because if we're looking at the total installations of decentralized PV applications in the last 5 years, we can see that to a certain extent, from 2011 to 2015, they were stable. And on the other side, the share of centralized application increased dramatically from close to 14 gigawatts in 2011. It increases to more than 33 gigawatts last year, and I have little doubt that this is going to continue. It's relatively obvious when we're looking at China, for instance, that most attempts to develop the distributed segments are not so easy, and that in most cases, what we can see is that the centralized applications are developing faster simply because they are simpler to put in place, the regulations are simpler, while the regulation for distributed PV applications are extremely complex. And they are extremely complex when countries are willing to transition from a net metering scheme, for instance, to a self-consumption driven scheme. I'm not going to go too much in depth about that today, but I would like to give you an insight on what were the drivers in 2015 that enabled the development of the PV market. And if we're looking at financial incentives, so financial incentives such as feed-in tariffs, feed-in premium, green certificates, direct subsidies, tax breaks, they represented more than 75% of the PV markets. So it means that three-fourths of the PV market globally was still driven in 2015 by financial incentives. And out of these financial incentives, the feed-in tariffs represented a very large share, so 60% of all PV installations in the world were still driven by feed-in tariffs. Now, if we are looking at the call for tenders that have been extremely trendy in the last 2 years because they showed how PV could be competitive, they represent a rather small share of the markets. So the feed-in tariffs that have been granted through tenders, so the PPAs, represent only 5.6% of the market in 2015. I expect that this number is going to increase in the coming years, but for the time being, it means that the super competitive PV installations that we have seen with announcements of PPA bids won below $3 per kilowatt hour in some regions of the world, especially in the Middle East and in Latin America, are part of a very small part of the global PV markets, so a bit more than 5%. Now, if we're looking at incentivized self-consumption or net metering, what I was saying before about the difficulties to set up regulations to kickstart the development of the distributed PV segments in some countries is reflected in the numbers. 15% of the global PV market is directly incentivized by or directly driven by self-consumption or net metering schemes. This is something extremely interesting when we're looking at the PV markets, and I was referring to oil in the beginning. Oil has been and still is in a certain number of countries heavily subsidized. So we shouldn't be too afraid of these numbers for the future of the PV markets, because I think that to a certain extent energy will always be subsidized to a certain extent in many countries. Now, even if it represents a small fraction, or it represented in 2015 a small fraction of the market, it's interesting to look at all the PPA values from recent tenders. And this figure that has been published in the last trends report is coming from a figure from the IEA compiling all the PPAs. But in general, we compare apples and pears when we compare a PPA in the US, a PPA in Germany, or a PPA in the Middle East. So what has been done here is just to normalize these values by simply recalculating what could be the LCOE of a PV system in regions with either, and that's the blue part, a yield at 1,000 kilowatt hours per kilowatt peak. That's, I would say, the German case and the case for a large part of Central and, I would say, Northern Europe. And in red, a yield at 2,000 kilowatt hours per kilowatt peak, which is the case in a certain number of sunny regions of the world, including in South Europe. If we are looking at plants recently developed in some countries, I'm thinking about Latin America and especially in Argentina, we have now with first axis trackers in some regions yields that could go up to 3,000 kilowatt hours per kilowatt peak. So it means that basically in theory we could even go lower than what is mentioned on this figure. Two small conclusions from this figure. The first one is that over time, the PPAs granted to competitive PV plants through tenders went down significantly. The second conclusion is that basically if we could apply the same conditions to less sunny countries, we could in any case produce PV electricity below 10 US dollar cents per kilowatt hour, and in many places below 5 or 6 US dollar cents per kilowatt hour, which would make PV virtually competitive with a lot of existing power sources. And if we could go even lower, and this is something that we see every day that is possible, going below 5, 4 or even 3, then PV becomes the cheapest source of electricity all over the world. And this is going to frame significantly the development of PV in the coming years. Now, and this is something that we will see with Christian Breyer at the end of this webinar, the question is on the long term whether PV will be a major source of electricity is basically extremely simple. It's going to happen. It's a no-brainer. The question is what's going to happen in the coming years. I'd like to show these numbers which are coming from a study from PV Market Alliance, and I'm pleased to have Izumi Kaizuka from RTS speaking after me, which could show to a certain extent that under the current conditions and given the very fast development of the Chinese PV markets in 2016, there are unfortunately a certain probability that the market in 2017 could be lower than the market in 2016 or at a similar level. In the PV sector, forecasting is always a difficult exercise, so it's extremely hard to say what could happen exactly, but my guess is that after a significant boom this year in a certain number of markets, we will see a dramatic consolidation in 2017. The question is how emerging markets, and I'm thinking about India, but also all these markets which are developing all over the world for the time being, will compensate it. The market decrease in a certain number of key countries. Again, if you're looking at prospects for development in the coming years, and this is a medium scenario, we can see again that centralized PV applications should remain much higher than distributed PV applications. I've already discussed about that, so I will not spend too much time on it. I will now move to something slightly different, which is again discussing about what's the level at which PV is able to produce electricity these days. These numbers have been taken from a study from the European PV Technology and Innovation Platform that has been published last year and which is available on their website, which shows how important the question of the cost of capital is in the final cost of PV electricity. And two cases have been taken. One is the UK, the other one is Italy. And so basically what you can see if you're looking at the blue part is the importance of operation and maintenance costs, but also, and these are the green, the black, and the yellow part, how important the cost of capital can be in raising or decreasing the final cost of PV electricity. But, and UK is an interesting case because the average yield in the UK is below 1,000 kilowatt hours per kilowatt peak per year. It shows that under the current conditions in the residential sector, it's already possible to produce electricity now with, I would say, an LCOE around, I would say, 10 US dollar cents per kilowatt hour. In the figure, these are euro cents, but you will have done the conversion yourself. And if you're looking at another country in Europe, Italy, which has a higher irradiation, then we can see something extremely interesting, is that basically in Italy, PV is already competitive. I'm not discussing too much about the question of self-consumption and how the ratios of self-consumption are impacting the competitiveness of PV. I would like to give you a hint about how cheap PV electricity has become in the last years. And when we're saying that's basically under a 2% nominal WACC, which is something that could be feasible without too many problems in many countries for residential applications, if we're using money that otherwise would have been put on a savings account. Basically, in Italy, we could produce PV electricity on a residential roof for around 6-7 US dollar cents per kilowatt hour. This changes completely the perspective that we could have on PV. So, I was saying at a certain moment that I believe that PV will become the cheapest source of electricity in the world in all market segments. The question is when. Some people believe it could be 2050, some people believe 2030. I don't believe it. I think it's already happening now, and basically before 2020, and in any case before 2025, PV will be the cheapest source of electricity. It means that it's going to impact the way how we think energy in general, or we produce, or we consume energy, and it means it's going to help the energy transition or support the energy transition in buildings by shifting from fuel to from fossil fuels, including wood, to electricity, the production of heat, the production of cold, and this is something that gains more traction for the time being, e-mobility. If this happens in the coming years, PV will be the major driver of the energy transformation. And this will happen only because PV is already an extremely cheap source of electricity. Just to give you some ideas about whether, and it comes from the same study, about which countries have already reached a certain level of, I don't like the term of grid parity, but it's the case. Basically, it shows that even in northern European countries where the prices of electricity are high, at a certain moment PV will be competitive, but with a low cost of capital, which is something that should be reachable in almost all market segments, then we could simply see that PV could be already competitive in most European countries, or in any case in 2020 or soon after 2020, it will be the case. Now I would like to start concluding by giving you a different perspective. This is a figure that has been shown already a certain number of times, and I would like to thank Alexander Gerlach and Chris Werner, who I've seen are attending this call as well, for having provided the IEA-PVPS with their numbers about non-IEA-PVPS countries. It shows that basically the penetration of PV has reached very rapidly extremely high levels in a certain number of countries. We are used to see the cases of Italy, the case of Germany and Greece, who we know are the three highest countries in terms of PV penetration, but there are interesting cases such as Honduras, for instance, which has reached more than 12% of PV penetration in its electricity demand in only 2 years. So it's not something that requires an important number of years to be achieved, it's something that can be achieved easily. The entire world has passed the 1% mark somewhere in 2014, and I hope we will reach 2% in the probably two or three coming years. What is extremely interesting as well is that we should look, and it's something that I'm saying very often, we should look at these numbers not with regards to the total electricity demand in the country, but with regard to the peak electricity demand, so the moment at which PV is producing. And in that case, the penetration is much higher. And in terms of instantaneous penetration of PV, we have many countries where PV together, for instance, with wind or with conventional sources, has reached more than 50% of the electricity demand instantaneously. That's not the subject for today, but the electricity systems of these countries haven't crashed when they were running up to 100% of variable renewable electricity. I would like now to conclude by saying I'm sure the PV market is going to continue developing. The question of what can happen from one year to another is more about temporary conditions. The utility scale PV markets will still be driven by competitive prices, and the prices went down significantly in the last 6 months, perhaps for overcapacity causes. This is something that I will remind in a certain number of minutes, but under normal conditions, the competitive price are going to ensure the development of the utility scale markets in a certain number of countries. Prosumers, so distributed PV applications, should become a driving force, but, and that's what I was saying in the beginning, regulations are to a certain extent complex and require a very, very deep involvement from policymakers. Then, and this is something that could delay slightly the development of PV in a certain number of countries, competitive prices, and then I'm thinking about LCOE, so the cost of the kilowatt hours that we are generating, are clearly linked to two situations which are to a certain extent temporary. First, the extremely low component prices on the markets. I don't expect them to go significantly higher, but in any case, the prices for the time being are slightly unsustainable. So it means that basically we could see, I would say, price stabilization in the two coming years. But there is something even more important. It's the question of the extremely low interest rates that we see all over the world for the time being. An increase of the interest rates would have a significant impact on the ability to reach extremely low PPAs in a certain number of cases. So this is something that will have to be scrutinized precisely. If interest rates are going up, the weighted average cost of capital for PV system will also go up if this happens in the coming years. Now something also important is that the short term remains uncertain. That's something that I have said before. We have many questions about the PV market evolution in China, in Japan, in the US, in Europe, and we have many questions about the ability of emerging markets to compensate it for the possible losses in these markets. Just remind that 90% of the market is in the hands of 10 countries or even less than 10 countries. So it means that from one year to another, we could see dramatic changes because of policy decisions in one, two, three countries. But on the long term, I have no doubt that PV will continue developing. I think that the long term can only be positive, of course, under condition. And I would like everyone to remind that PV is already the cheapest source of electricity in a certain number of countries and market segments, and this is something that will continue to spread in the coming years. Of course, it's very frightening for many people because it means that all conventional sources of electricity will be endangered by the dramatic development of PV in the coming years. I think it's time to spill solar electricity and to use it basically for all possible uses. And I would like to thank you for your attention with this little figure that illustrates what I think about the evolution of mankind. I think that PV will contribute significantly to better the conditions of life of millions of people or billions of people in the coming years. It will also democratize the energy sector, which is still heavily centralized. And basically, before giving the floor to our next speaker, I would like to thank you a lot for your attention.
Thank you, Gaëtan, for your excellent and very positive presentation. I'm sure the entire audience appreciated your graphs and your very positive outlook. I'm going to hand over to our next speaker, but before I do so, I would like to remind the audience to please submit your questions via typing. So please type your questions for our panelist speakers and we will read them out in the Q&A session. So now we will go to our next speaker who is joining us from Japan, from Tokyo, Izumi Kaizuka from RTS Corporation. And Izumi will speak to us all about the state of the PV industry in this presentation. So the screen is now yours, Izumi.
Okay, thank you, Joanna. Now, first of all, I'd like to thank you, ISIS, for this webinar. And also I'd like to thank to the, all of my colleagues of the PVPS Task 1. In this presentation, I'd like to use my slides from my work and my company, RTS Corporation, so that I'd like to briefly introduce about my company. The RTS is established in 1983 and we are working for the industry in Japan and overseas. And the, I'm very happy to help the companies from overseas with Japanese business. So now I'd like to move on to my presentation. That this slide shows the contents of the Chapter 4 of the Trends Report, just published in this October. This chapter basically has two parts about the upstream PV sector, and from this year we added the downstream sector. In this presentation, I'd like more focus on the upstream PV sector because of the time limitations. The upstream sector from polysilicon to the PV module manufacturer situation. And most of the my figures are from the trends report, so that that describes situation of the 2015, but now it's December of 2016, so I'd like to put some more current information as much as possible. Yes, the, this slide summarizes the polysilicon production situation in 2015. In 2015, the almost 33,000 tons of polysilicons are used for solar cells. And 2015, the situation might be same as in this year. The China was the largest producer with the 16,000 tons of polysilicon. That accounts for the more than 50% of the global production. And China is also the largest consumer. In addition to the domestic production, the China imported close to the 10,000 tons of the polysilicon. Other major producing countries are Germany, South Korea, US, Japan, Malaysia, and Norway. The 2015, it was very significant for the price decline of the polysilicon. In end of the in January, the price of the poly was $20 per kilogram, but it's declined to the $13 per kilogram in December 2015. This decline continued until September of this year, $12, but now because of the global demand came back, increased increased from the fourth quarter. Now the price is $14.6 per kilogram. But this is a quite low level for the polysilicon manufacturers. But the next slide, as next slide shows, the polysilicon manufacturing production capacity is well surpassing the demand for the polysilicon. But many players still continue the efforts of the cost down with higher quality or improving the process or adapting the FBR process that requires less electricity or metallurgical process. And this slide shows the silicon consumption for solar cells, blue line, and the production capacity. The, as you can see, still in 2016, despite the demand growth, still market is buyer's market. Next, I'd like to talk about PV cell production. The, in 2015, our analysis, the global cell production is close to 63 gigawatt. The, maybe this year, the solar cell production is close to the 75 gigawatt. I will talk later. And again, the largest producer and consumer was China. China accounts for the more than 65% of the PV module production in 2015. And this situation will not change this year, I think. And the module production, the picture of the module production is similar as cell production. The global production amount was around 63 gigawatt, and the largest producer is again China. But the, this chart shows the difference between the production capacity and production. And in the end of this year, the production capacity is close to the 90 gigawatt, and still the we have the difference of the supply and demand. The, this is the reason now the PV module price is sharply declining. And next chart, this is a little bit busy. I don't want to read all the numbers, but I'd like to emphasize that the most of the PV module suppliers manufacturing solar cells as well. But if we see the rankings of the top 10 solar cell manufacturers and PV module manufacturers, you can see the different companies are positioned in the different ranks. The, this is because the many PV module manufacturers now has their own strategy of the manufacturing framework from silicon wafers, solar cell, and PV modules. And the number one solar cell producer was Hanwha Qcells from Korea, but the number one PV module producer was Trina Solar in China. And Trina Solar positioned as the second largest solar cell manufacturer. And the, this shows the major manufacturers' trends of the production capacity. As you can see, the most of the PV module manufacturers has the largest production capacity for PV modules. That means some of the solar cells they are procuring from outside the, because of the trade conflict or other strategic reasons. And I showed the 2015's ranking of the PV module and cell suppliers. This ranks seemed to change in this year. This is just the top five companies in PV module manufacturers. The according to the IR report and other information, the 2016 top one manufacturer will be Jinko Solar from China. Then maybe the Torina Solar will be the second, and the Canadian Solar positioned number three, according to the guidance. So the top producers change 2 years or 3 years, and that shows, I think, that this industry is not the phase of the maturity. And I think further consolidation might be happen next year or in the short term. And the next slide shows the technological share of the PV modules. The in the left chart, you see the production amount of the crystalline solar PV modules and thin films. And the right chart shows the share of the thin film technology. Sorry, the indicator missed for some reasons, but the green part shows the share of the cadmium telluride, and the purple bar shows the share of the CIGS, and the red bar shows the share of the thin film silicon. And the among the thin film PV module manufacturers, I think the First Solar cadmium telluride PV module has the highest share. Then the Solar Frontier, a Japanese CIS PV module manufacturer, positioned second. And it's very interesting. Recently, the thin film efficiencies significantly improving. This is a slide from the First Solar, and now the best efficiency of the cadmium telluride PV module is 2012.1%, the surpassing the multicrystalline silicon levels. And also the Solar Frontier Japan reported they achieved 2012.3 efficiency. So the at now the speed of the production capacity expansion, the crystalline silicon surpass the thin films, but still efficiency is improving both technologies. And maybe the thin film technologies have some spaces for the BIPV or application in the hot weathers. And I think that still the thin films will be developing the its efficiency. And the next, I'd like to briefly talk about the trade conflict over the solar cells and PV modules. This is very complicated figures, but the imposing duties to the Chinese product in Europe or US that causes the some problems for the downstream developers. And in US, the polysilicon suppliers, it's difficult to import their products to the polysilicon products to China because of the duties. So the outside of the China, the polysilicon market, for example, in Taiwan, the price of the polysilicon is the cheapest at now because of this conflict. And also the Chinese manufacturers are now extending their production bases all over the world. This shows the just to do the example of the overseas factories of the China and Taiwanese companies. I think the producing PV module close to the demand location might be good opportunity to reduce the cost. And it's very interesting. At now, China accounts for the more than 65% of the production share. But in case of PV modules, we will see the more distribution in the future. Okay, now the upstream industries are facing various challenges. One is overcapacity. This results in the lower margin for manufacturing. And also, the now stock performance is quite bad. So I think the consolidation will continue all the phases. For example, recently, Tokuyama, Japanese polysilicon producer, decided to sell their Malaysian polysilicon factory to OCI of Korea. And maybe we will hear the other announcement in the future. And also, the four manufacturing companies, the financing is quite difficult at now. Most of the IPO cases are downstream companies of the PV industries. And as I said, this figure is until 2014, but still the overcapacity continues, maybe next year. And at now, the price of the PV module is less than 40 US cents. And some of the module manufacturer reported their production cost of the PV module is 39 cent dollars per watt. So it's very difficult to make the profit from the module manufacturing at now. But anyway, these manufacturers need to survive. So the way of the differentiation is one of the several ways they need to take. One is manufacturing cost. Still, there's space of the reduction of the materials, changing the silver paste to the copper, or keep the operation ratio, or also the standardization of the material is very important. And for products, the higher efficiency the manufacturers seeking, that if the solar cell manufacturer can increase 1% of the cell efficiency, that result in the maybe the 5% of the cost down of the price down the PV modules. And also the reliability is very important. Maybe the PV module, some of the analysts says it's commodity, but the PV module is a commodity. You have to use more than 20 years or sometimes 25 years. So the reliability for the PV modules becomes very important. And also the module manufacturers needs to seek the added value as a BIPV or the energy solution combining PV plus home energy management or batteries. And also the manufacturers have to define the segments seeking high-end product or volume zone. That maybe the Japanese PV manufacturers or LG from Korea or Sunpower, they are targeting the high-end zone with the high efficiency products. And also because of the lower margins, the manufacturers need to think about business models. Now the polysilicon manufacturer like LG or OCI, they have their own PV project. And also the Canadian Solar or Jinko, they are keeping balance of their financial situation with the downstream projects. This shows the utility PV application project players in the some of the suppliers, as I said, now plays as a developer of the PV projects. So maybe for the downstream sectors, the current price down is a good news, but the suppliers have to survive for a very difficult time in next year. But it's the market will be developed. The speed is more than we expected in several years ago. So I'm very optimistic. Maybe the 2017 for suppliers, it may be the winter, but soon the another cycle of the PV market will realize. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Izumi, for your presentation. I'm going to go straight to our next presenter now. Joining us from Finland, Christian Breyer from Lappeenranta University of Technology, who will explain to us about PV in 100% RES scenarios. Before I give the screen to you completely, Christian, I wanted to thank everybody for their questions that are coming in and encourage the audience to please continue to submit questions and remember to specify who the speaker is to answer your question. Okay, thank you. Christian, the floor is now fully yours.
Thanks, Johanna. So I want to continue immediately on 100% renewable energy scenarios for PV. First of all, it was not yet mentioned in this webinar, so I want to bring it back into the mind. One of the key reasons why we have to go to very high levels of sustainability in energy systems is that we have a major problem on our planet. We are burning currently ourselves. So we have a major problem with the absorption capacity of our planet, of our emissions, and currently it's mainly CO2. And the target from the World Society is by the mid of the century, or let's say very early in the second half of this century, we should have a net zero emission society. And that means that the energy system in particular needs to be fully decarbonized. So that we need to have in mind. Okay, now let's have an overview on the global energy transition scenarios. Not all of them are 100%. Actually, it's only a minority. But these are roughly the scenarios we have. So just go through about the covers. So there is from Bloomberg covering mainly electricity, then Greenpeace covering the entire energy system. And I can already conclude it here, this is the most advanced global energy scenario we have so far. None other scenario is on this quality level. World Energy Outlook, sorry, this is still the numbers from 2015, but 2016 is not much different from that. Then there is a wide forward-looking scenario from IEA-PVPS, which is Energy from Desert, it's a book. Then we have IRENA REMAP 2030. We have WWF energy report, now already some years old, so maybe update may have kind of a better expression of current numbers. Then we have the Global Energy Assessment. I think this is the most comprehensive forward-looking assessment of energy we ever had in history. Then the IPCC report in climate change. Then Worlds in Transition, which is from a kind of advisory group for the German government, which is the oldest of all of this report, but one of the best done ever in history. So even more than 10 years later, it's worth looking into it. Paper by Jacobson and DiLucci. And then comes a group of quite interesting scenarios. So the first is Shell. This is the only one which is qualified by quality standards to be part of the group. Then we have ExxonMobil, but due to two less disclosed numbers, it had to be excluded due to quality reasons, the same for BP, and unfortunately also from the MIT, which does not fulfill the quality standards we require here. Okay, but now let's come to the overview. So I will not go into detail with all numbers of the table, but you see what I just introduced before, and then you can also see it for different scenarios. And then you see the different columns, what is the expectation in the decades to come. First of all, the PV capacity. There you see numbers. I will go on in the next slide to explain the numbers a bit more, because you see lower numbers and higher numbers. Maybe on the bottom line of this table, you see the range. So the PV capacity expected from 2030, 40, 50 is from less than 1,000 gigawatts to up to 4,000 in 2030, and these numbers increase then in the decades to come. But already there you can see with the spread it's not really a consensus. Then we have the share of PV for the total primary energy demand on electricity. And there you can see there are some scenarios where we have a higher share of PV, others which seem to be, and they are typically marked in green, then we have others which are on the more, how to say, medium level, these are orange, and then we have ones with extremely low number, which are red. Again, the spread, you see it on the bottom line, is from 2030 as a contribution of PV from 3% up to 15 or 16%. And in 2050, the spread is not so huge anymore, but the reason is that the most conservative scenarios do not yet provide numbers for 2050. And then in the last column, we see the share on the solar total primary energy demand. And this does not cover now anymore electricity. It covers all energy sectors. We have more. We have the transportation sector. We have the heat demand. We have the industrial demand. But the overall picture is the same. We have very forward-looking scenarios with a high share of solar energy. And to pick them out, it's mainly Greenpeace. It's a forward-looking scenario of the PVPS, IEA-PVPS, then ARENA scenarios by 2050, WWF, and then some scenarios of the Global Energy Assessment. They're also with high numbers. When it comes to the IPCC, for the next few decades, the numbers are rather low. When it comes on the very long-term horizon, then there is also acknowledged that solar should play a major role. And then just highlighting the line from this WBTU, which is this German advisory group, they have a share of solar which is the highest we found so far of two-thirds from the total energy supply in the year 2100. So the numbers range from a very small contribution up to two-thirds. So in other words, there is not really a good consensus. As you can see on the next slide, which the overview numbers you see now on the capacity numbers from 2030, we have less than 1,000 up to 4,000. And in 2050 from 7,000 gigawatts up to 30,000. So there is non-consensus in this, how to say, energy community on this, on the role of PV. You see it in the PV share in the electricity supply. It just reflects the capacity numbers from 2030, 3% to 16%. And we know already today there are countries beyond or at the level of 10%. So from a technical point of view, it can be done, that we know now. And from 2050, we have numbers from 20 to 30%. What you can see here also is that, of course, when it comes to the total primary energy demand, the solar photovoltaic share is expected to further rise. And the reason is that we have a major trend right now is the electrification of also other parts of the energy sectors. When you just see the pictures below, we're talking on electricity-based heat pumps, we're talking on electric vehicles, we're starting to talk on electric trucks, we are talking, and this is already a two-third market share of new installations, electricity-based desalination, so clean water, of course, is a major demand sector in the future in many parts in the world. And we see the first, let's say, demonstration plans, early commercialization of synthetic fuels, power-based fuels. So we can produce with power-to-gas technologies, natural gas substitute and synthetic natural gas, and the same we can do with jet fuel, diesel, petrol, everything can be built or produced based on electricity. Now I want to show you how 100% renewable electricity supply could look like. This is an overview of what we do in my research team. First of all, I want to emphasize we're talking on one hourly resolution, which had been not yet done on a global scale. So all these global scenarios take into account only a single day in hourly resolution or only annual numbers. But of course, this is not really favorable when we're talking on solar and wind, where we have intermittent resources, so we need to do it in a much, much higher temporal resolution. And due to that, we decided to have it in a full hourly resolution for an entire real weather year with, based on real data. And the target of this modeling is to find the least cost solution for the energy system for given constraints. Constraints might be a kind of a maximum acceptance of wind energy, what is the available biomass resource, what is the available hydropower resource. So to bring everything together to find the most, how to say, optimized system view, taking into account also the constraints. And maybe something more to be mentioned, so the world is in our model structured in 145 regions, and these 145 regions are again aggregated to 9 major regions in the world. The system itself, you can see here, is a bit color-coded that you can easily or better identify how it works. So from the renewable resources, nearly everything is represented. We put some emphasis to represent solar photovoltaics on a good level. So we have prosumer PV on the rooftops, we have fixed tilted utility scale PV and one axis tracking PV. Wind, it's mainly onshore. For Europe, we also made possible to have offshore wind, because currently more or less all offshore wind is installed in Europe. From the hydropower, we have runoff river and the dams. Geothermal energy is there. We make it possible for the model to choose for concentrating solar thermal power. We have bioenergy, but we have the constraint that it should be not in competition to food production and, of course, waste to energy. From the grid is allowed to exchange from one of these 145 regions to the others. Currently, the losses of the grid within some region is not yet included, but in the next model update, it will be there. From the storage options, of course, today we use most pumped hydro storage. This is there with existing capacities. Storage of the future will be mainly batteries, which is available for the model. Compressed air energy storage would be available. Power to gas for seasonal storage, but it's more used for the non-energetic gas demand in industry. And from the demand sectors, the electricity sector is fully represented. Then we have even made possible water desalination and the industrial gas demand. I will not go through all the numbers of this table, but I want to tell you the major trend. So there you see the results for all of these 9 major world regions. So it's Europe, Eurasia, Northeast Asia, Southeast Asia, India, SAARC, the MENA region, Sub-Saharan Africa, North and South America. What we see there is that, first of all, 100% renewables, and we modeled it for real weather years. The real weather year had been in our example here, the year 2005. And the financial and the technical assumptions we applied for this scenario or for this modeling is the year 2030. So all demand numbers are from 2030, all technical assumptions are from 2030, and the cost assumptions are from 2030. Maybe I should mention that solar photovoltaics might be too conservative. In 2030 we may see lower prices, so even that could push the numbers. But then let's focus more on the cost. So we have different scenarios. I don't want to go into details of the region-wide and area-wide scenario, but the area-wide scenario means that in all of these 9 major regions in the world, the different sub-regions within this major region, they are allowed to trade and exchange electricity, which is, for example, the case as of today in Europe or within China or within India or in North America. It's practiced for decades. So this is allowed. And then you see what is the cost range, and the cost range including the generation of all this electricity, transmission with the grids, of course the storage costs are fully included for 100% renewables, and even some curtailment if some energy had to be dumped, it's included. And then you see the cost range for this 2030 cost assumptions. It's between roughly, let's say, 50 to 70 euros a megawatt hour. And that will be fully loaded cost, including cost of capital. So we have a weighted average cost of capital of 7% assumed. Now is the question, 50 to 70 euros a megawatt hour, is that competitive? And that we can compare to what are the latest costs of at least European nuclear technology. There we have a feed-in tariff agreement in the UK for 110 euros a megawatt hour. So it's much, much higher than a 100% renewable system. So the energy demand can be not the only reason to spend this huge amount of subsidies. And of course, for the fossil sector, when we want to be in the net zero world, it need to be carbon capture and storage, but still the today's efficiency there are not good enough. It's only 80-90% capturing efficiency, but we need 100%, so even that, it's kind of a technical failure, it's not good enough. But if we just would take this not into account, then still we see we're talking on 110-120 euros a megawatt hour, which is much higher than a 100% renewable solution. So concluding this part, nuclear and fossil-based CCS may have extreme hard economic times ahead. Giving you the overview of the capacities for these 9 major world regions, you see it's dominated by yellow, orange and blue. This means blue is wind energy, it's an energy numbers around half globally, and most regions in the world are plus minus, let's say 10-20% around this 50% contribution share by wind for 2030 assumptions. When it comes to yellow and orange, this is solar. The orange is utility scale solar, typically one axis tracking, because the LCOE is a bit lower than for fixed tilted, but what is even more important, we get 15-25% more yield per installed capacity on a very, very low cost level. So this is extremely valuable for the entire energy system. And this brighter yellow is typically prosumer PV, whether it's on residential or commercial or industrial roofs. When it comes to the storage, you see it's dominated by batteries. The dark red is more utility scale batteries. The bright red is more self-consumption, so prosumer batteries, and these are the main storage options. Of course, existing pumped hydro storage is used, and some power to gas is used for seasonal balancing. I just want to give you one example how it's done in a higher spatial resolution for India. You see the blue link bottom right. When you click there later on in the document, you get a full paper, and in the appendix of this presentation, which is made available on the ISIS website, there you can find such diagrams for all of the 9 major world regions and where you can get further information. So this is just an example how this would look like. And India is chosen because there the solar share is the highest in the world, and the reason is excellent solar conditions, but still there is a lot of wind, and the reason is the monsoon. What you can see here, so this is one of the regions in India when it's kind of a typical of the 9 months without monsoon, how it would work. The system on hourly resolution, there is a lot of sun during daytime, the batteries are charged during late afternoon, evening, night hours, the batteries are discharged, and then the next day the same cycle starts again. And then we have some additional balancing, whether it's hydropower, whether it's biomass, you see it typically in the night hours. But when we have the monsoon, then we have a lot of clouds, solar conditions are not as good, but luckily the wind resource is really excellent, as you can see here. During monsoon months, then the wind resource is much, much better. You can visualize this, so in the document which can be downloaded, you see these links. We have called this online tool Global Internet of Energy, where you can go in for all of these 145 regions, structured in the 9 major world regions, where you can visualize an entire year in an hourly resolution how this system would work, depending on different scenarios. There is then grid exchange with neighbors, yes or no. And then you can study how such a 100% electricity system may work in reality in 15, 20, 30 years time in future. And all the data which is visualized can be downloaded there. So it's 600 megabytes of Excel files you can download and go deeper when you want. Now let's a bit summarize the numbers. What does it mean? First of all, it's quite interesting. The PV prosumer and PV power plants all in all would express 1/3 and 2/3 of the total PV market. According to our analysis, which matches quite interestingly exactly what is currently the global market. So roughly 2/3 are utility scale centralized PV power plants, and 1/3 is more prosumer based decentralized distributed. And exactly this is something we found in the data, which might be also a kind of a long-term stable condition. And when it comes to the PV share, we find with this 2030 assumptions around 40% share for PV. Now I want to show you explanatory energy transition scenario for the case of Saudi Arabia. Top left, you can see how the electricity system in generation may evolve. Of course, we have a kind of a best policy scenario, so assuming least cost electricity prices are the target of a country, net zero emissions should be the target by 2050, so this is assumed as a major constraint, but then such a transition could look like this. We start with gas and oil, oil is too expensive, then we come to gas, and step by step, first of all more wind, but then more and more solar is brought into the system. What you can see top right, the cost go down, so the more, the higher the share of renewables is, the higher, the lower is the cost. And by 2050, the total cost will be dominated by PV, solar, and batteries, plus then all the rest. And the storage share might be rather high. What is quite interesting for such a sunbelt country with low seasonal variation, or rather low, the solar share by 2050 could be up to 80%. So for 2030 assumptions, global average, we have 40%, but it could be up to 80% for excellent solar conditions, countries in the sunbelt. This has been just published yesterday for Turkey. There you see the characteristic rather similar, but Turkey's energy system is currently based mainly on hydro, gas and coal. So even that can be then shifted in 3 decades towards a 100% renewable system. The cost may be more or less stable with a small declining trend towards mid of the century. And this is for Ukraine, another example where it's also quite interesting that it can be phased out coal, it can be phased out nuclear, coming to a 100% renewable system. Doing this, how to say, step by step or slightly in parallel, again, the cost would decline. Okay, now let's summarize, come to an end, demand for solar PV. Based on this 100% renewable energy modeling for 2030, we would have 12,000 gigawatts or 12 terawatts of demand. Integrated scenario means the demand is based on the electricity sector plus seawater desalination plus industrial gas demand. However, we cover only roughly 50%, 45% of the total primary energy demand, so the heating sector and mobility sector mainly is missing and other industrial demand sectors. So if we would take that into account, then we may end up around 30 terawatts, so 27 is here the number, if we would have a full integration for all energy sectors with around 40% solar PV contribution share. But of course, this is not the end of the story, because 2030 total primary energy demand may be only about 60% of the total primary energy demand of 10 billion people during the second half of the century, so that may boost further the numbers to 40 terawatts. And of course, we could have even higher shares of solar. So this is based on a 40% solar share, but we saw examples that the share could be higher than 40%. And just remember, this German advisory group more than 10 years ago, they had shares of up to 70%. This is now the last slide. What will be all insights? First of all, the prosumer PV is a major trend all around the world, but not in highly subsidized electricity markets. So we see excellent business cases for PV prosumer in Denmark, but not in Egypt. And the reason is not the sun, but subsidy for electricity prices. Batteries are the most suited storage technology for PV, so I would call this kind of a dream couple. Low battery prices push PV and vice versa. So these two technologies should be in a kind of integrated view. Major electricity generation technologies are solar PV and wind, and then plus all the rest. Electricity-based energy system is very efficient. Just think on electric vehicles, heat pumps, they're much, much more efficient than our today's solutions. The generation is rather close to demand, so the storage seems to be more competitive than very long distance supply. Long distance means more than 2,000 kilometers. We never found power lines more than 2,000 kilometers in our global modeling, which can compete to more regional storage-based solutions. The storage demand is typically overestimated due to a lack of sector integrated view. However, the storage demand may increase beyond 2030 due to the fact that solar is so incredibly low cost, and this would boost the battery demand. PV share expected to rise due to highly competitive relative cost trend of PV. Gaëtan already mentioned it earlier with these PPAs, and we expect this can continue. But in future, batteries are maybe even more important to enable a higher share of solar to get it shifted within the 24-hour frame. And then it could be the 40%, maybe even upgraded to 80%. Fossils, carbon capture and storage and nuclear energy are not competitive on a full cost basis. The leading reports so far are from Bloomberg New Energy Finance, but they focus only mainly on the electricity sector, but they're excellent, and then Greenpeace for a full view on the full energy system. A net zero world does not mean a reduced standard of living, much more technologies, we have to do it better than in the past, and of course the burning age ends, and the reason are low efficiency and high societal standards. I want to thank in particular to my team, which made it possible. When you are a researcher, you can access to all our publications at ResearchGate, and you can follow via Twitter, where all new publications from our team are made accessible. Many thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Christian, for your excellent and very, very informative presentation. I will now quickly move on to the Q&A session. We still have 10 minutes time, so I'm going to try and get through your answers. Gaëtan Masson has kindly already answered many of your questions via typing, so let me get through the ones that are still unanswered. So we have a question here about guaranteeing first class and excellence in manufacturing. So the question is, if China is becoming a kind of almost unique global PV supplier, what are the current initiatives that guarantee first class and excellence in the manufacturing, working and operating conditions? So Gaëtan, do you want to try to answer that one?
Yeah, I will try to answer it very, very quickly, because it's a very complex question that I could summarize by saying China put in place a framework for manufacturing development which is one of the best in the world. It's not the only country that achieved that, but basically it succeeded in bringing a certain number of companies from a small to level to global market players, and it would require, I think, one entire hour to explain everything that has been put in place to ensure that. So we can continue this point by private mail if you prefer.
Okay, good. We have a bit of a conversation going, I see, in the questions regarding how much energy consumption is perceived to be used and the suggestion of why not looking at absolute numbers in terms of terawatt hours as well. So I'll read out the question. As you say, there is no convergence. So this is for Christian Breyer. As you say, there is no convergence on analysis of what PV would deliver in the future until 2050 or 2100. Since percentage share of power or and energy might not be precise enough to show potentials because it all depends how much energy consumption is perceived to be used, why not looking at absolute numbers in terms of terawatt hours as well?
Yeah, many thanks for these questions. Of course, I fully agree. This is exactly what we do. So the relative numbers is only the result at the end of the analysis. The analysis itself is based on the absolute numbers. So the absolute numbers, as it had been done, what we have shown is there is a demand in the electricity sector in absolute terawatt hours in all of these 145 regions. And then the model has to allocate based on the available resources what is the least cost match of the demand for every hour of the year with the given resources. The next step in the modeling is that we include all energy sectors, and then it will be the same for heating demand, the same for mobility demand, that we have absolute demand numbers in energy units, so whether it's terawatt hours of electricity, of heat, or of gas, for example. So there is the absolute demand, and then, of course, then we are talking on energy transition scenarios based on the existing infrastructure which is there, but it can be further developed, of course, and existing capacities can be phased out at the end of the technical life, and then this given demand in absolute numbers is, has to be covered. And as a very, very end step, we can then conclude what might be a relative share for solar. But everything in the analysis is based on absolute numbers.
Thank you for your answer. Our next question is, can you repeat what the PV cell manufacturing costs are compared to market prices and talk a bit more about the possible profit of the manufacturers? So I think this one, Gaëtan, can you take this? Or Izumi, maybe you'd also like to join?
Izumi, I will take. The currently, the PV module price is maybe 39 cents. And one of the example I gave to was in case of the Tier 1 PV Chinese manufacturer. The recent IR presentation of the Canadian solar, they disclosed the estimated the manufacturing cost is 39 cent per watt for the second quarter of the 2016. So I'm not sure the average shipping price of the Canadian solar, but average price at this is the spot price, so the maybe the contract price, long-term contractors or volume contractors price is so much different, but the at now the even for the tier one Chinese manufacturers, the profit from the PV module is very, very thin. This is one of the reasons many companies go to the downstream sector as well.
I can add something to that. At least two companies have announced extremely low production cost by 2020, around 25 US dollar cents per watt. So there's something that is possible is that even if the prices on the market are below production costs of many actors for the time being, I think it will trigger a very dramatic decline in production costs in the coming years, forced by the market. But anyway, it will depend on the speed at which the market will evolve in the coming years and whether or not the overcapacity that exists in some part of the value chain for the time being will be compensated by market growth or not.
I'd like to also add the improvement of the efficiency. This month, at this October, I had many efficiency improvement from the crystalline silicon manufacturers, and also the material quality, polysilicon quality, can increase the efficiency. So the economy of the scale, the demand is also important, but also the many manufacturers making efforts for the cost down as well. That makes more profit than they hope.
Thank you very much for both of your answers. The next question is to Gaëtan. Renewable energy is most feasible in distributed form, this person says. Still, we see grid-connected and utility-scale plants grabbing the major share in leading countries. How long will this trend continue? Is this the best way to go ahead?
Okay, I wouldn't say that renewables by nature should be decentralized. I think it's another debate. It's the debate whether we should produce very close to the consumption centers or not. But in any case, with PV, I think all system sizes are contributing to the energy transformation, utility scale and distributed applications. And for the time being, the reason why centralized applications are developing faster, it's simply a cost and policy question. It's a cost question because they are extremely cheap to develop. It's a policy question because it's easier to put in place a tender and to grant a PPA rather than putting in place regulations for self-consumption, which might be in some cases extremely complex. But I believe that the future of PV will be a mix of decentralized and centralized applications.
Thank you very much. Our last question now, because we've run out of time, unfortunately, is to Christian. Two questions combining, I'm going to combine them into one. The question is, what are the reasons, do you think, for a CSP to be excluded from 100% renewable scenario? And also a person is asking a clarification on if offshore wind was in your model.
Yeah, many thanks for the questions. Offshore wind is part of the model. It was mainly taken into account in Europe, but whenever there is available area onshore At least our model want to build onshore first because it's lower in cost. However, we saw the latest tenders in Denmark for 50, 60 euros a megawatt hour for offshore wind. This is then a kind of a new quality. This is not reflected by a single scenario I've ever seen, including ours. So on this cost level, it would play a major role. We did the analysis, including it in Europe. In most of the other regions, the onshore area should be easier accessible due to lower population density available in these major rural areas. Coming to CSP, I'm personally a friend of CSP and I want to see a major role in our models, but our model, and this is very tricky for us as modelers, is based on cost. And we can only apply constraints. We are not allowed to, or at least we not allow ourselves to give minimum installations for a given technology. And what we see in CSP is that we have to see a cost decline soon. Otherwise, the technology has a major hurdle for the further development. Just recently, I was involved in the research on CSP. And there was the critical assumption that there need to be a tremendous growth ahead. That means from currently globally installed 5 gigawatts total installed, not per year, total installed capacity, 5 gigawatts. It has to grow as soon as possible on a level of 50 gigawatts and more. Otherwise, the cost competitiveness is very dramatic. And we even do now research how to compare a CSP plant where we have a storage included and even we have a steam turbine, so we can even burn some natural gas to have energy supply security in any given hour. But you can compare this to a PV power plant plus batteries plus a gas turbine. Then it's technically the same. And then is the question, when would be there a kind of a cost parity? And it may be 5, 8, 10 years time, depending on the load profile. So CSP has dramatically to reduce the cost and grow fast to do so. Otherwise, the future will be very, very challenging for CSP.
Thank you for answering that question. Unfortunately, there's so many more questions, but we don't have time anymore. We ran out. Gaëtan has already answered via typing, and I'd also like to encourage everybody online to download the presentations where you have the contact details of all the panelist speakers, and you can contact them directly with your questions as well. So we are at the end of our webinar. Thank you very much to our panelist speakers for sharing your knowledge and expertise with us today. Thank you very much to the IEA-PVPS for your kind sponsorship of this webinar. It was a really great session and I hope you all enjoyed it and found it informative as well. Today's webinar is the last in our webinar series for 2016. We have had the pleasure of hosting 12 excellent webinars with great topics, a very engaged audience, expert speakers and very supportive sponsors. And due to increased demand and positive feedback, I am happy to announce that we will continue the webinar series in 2017 on a monthly basis. Thank you all for your support. The next ISIS webinar will take place on the 25th of January 2017 and will focus on renewable district heating and local heat planning. We welcome you all to join. You may view today's webinar recording in a couple of hours on the ISIS website. So please check back on our website, www.ises.org, and also our YouTube channel. As mentioned before, ISIS members, you can log into your account and watch all the webinar recordings and view the presentations in the members area. If you have comments or feedback, we welcome you to share this with us so that we can continue to improve our webinar service for you. Please participate in the survey or send your feedback to public.relations@ises.org. Well, that's all we have time for today. I'm going to now close the webinar. Thank you all very, very much for your time.
Thank you very much. Have a nice day.
You too. Have a nice day, morning, evening, afternoon, whatever time it is in your part of the world.